stay on schedule. These interviews is not a good thing to get off schedule. I want to introduce to you Dr. William E. Moran, for whom the William E. Moran Endowed Professorship is named. We are exceptionally grateful for the support of the literacy program, and we're very happy that you could be here to see the candidate. For those of you who may not know, Dr. Moran was the chancellor from 1979 to 1994. At UNCG, and obviously has been a great supporter of the college after his tenure as chancellor. So I just wanted you to all know who this man was sitting in the room and why he was here, and that he was our special guest. So good questions. That's impressive. Good questions.
I also want to thank Dr. Moran. My first day here, he was in charge. And I knew he was a Michigan grad, so I bought him a Michigan pen. And his wife used to work in a department. She taught children's literature. And when my daughter was born, his wife sent her a little card, handwritten, with a quote from a children's book, which we put, of course, on the wall. So it's really quite pleasurable to see him here today. Thank you. I get the honor of introducing Kay, who's been a good friend for a long time. Welcome to UNCG, which I think you've been to before. You have roots in North Carolina. My family is from the Lumberton area. She'll talk about that. Degree from William and Mary, Virginia, and Georgia. What's interesting about those three places, with Virginia, she met and worked a little while with Henderson, who was the father of the work study programs that Francine developed that everybody else has used so much. So she has that background. Worked with Jim Bauman at Georgia. Jim is the only professor that I think I know who took a year off to teach first grade. So I think the influences on Gay's career for the work she's done in public schools, the close contact she's kept with them and the teachers. She's had close contact with schools and with teachers, but she's also been very productive professionally. She has over 50 publications in the top research journals in literacy, many of which, or most of which, she's first author. She was elected to the Reading Hall of Fame, which is a very distinct honor, held by the two previous recipients of the Moran Scholarship, Karen Wixon and Jerry Duffy. I think there's only about 50 people in the world who have been elected to that very prestigious honor. She's also president of LRA in her spare time. And I've already seen the influence on this year's agenda, where she's talking about expensive learning, which I find in her work and very influential in the stuff that I'm doing over at Hunter Elementary School. And Sam and I are working with teachers. We've been going through that work over and over again. And I always attend any of the sessions she has at LRA for the last 5 years, because I think she's really expanded how we think of learning and the effects of schooling way beyond what we see just in terms of test scores. Wherever she's gone, she's gotten awards. She's gotten teaching awards. She's gotten an award for community service, awards for research. So it's my honor and my privilege to introduce Gay to UNCG. Thank you.
It's going to drive you crazy, I know, if I stand over here, but I was told to talk for 30 minutes, and if I don't kind of stick to my notes that are on my computer, I will blow it. And so I apologize for making you sort of pivot in your seats, but I want to be able to say what I want to say this morning. Also, Sam, this is funny, and this is for all of you earlier career people in the room. Lesson learned, you mentioned the Reading Hall of Fame. I was inducted last summer and was kind of blindsided by the news that I had been elected. Not because I don't think I'm all that. Just kidding. I just thought I was too young, and I made the mistake of saying this. I've made the mistake of saying this to in an interview that was conducted by someone from my university's communications office, you know, thinking it was a local. And I said it as a joke, right? And so he printed that, which was fine locally. But last summer at the induction ceremony in Boston, sitting in the room of all of these luminaries and reading research who had voted to take me in or were welcoming me in, they actually had found that quote on the internet and mentioned it in my induction ceremony. So be careful what you say. So just in case, anything that I say today doesn't leave the room. You never know, but little lesson learned. I so appreciate the chance to talk to you. You know, at my own university, my department, we have 4 searches going on right now, and so I know what it means for you to take time out of your busy schedule and come to listen to whatever it is that I'm going to say today. And I really appreciate you coming and joining me today. It really does mean a lot. I call the title of my little talk to you today, The Transformative Potential of Literacy Learning, Teaching, and Research. And I hope to talk about the work that I've done and how it feeds into, you'll see at the end of my talk, my vision for what I think the Moran Distinguished Professorship could be. But I want to start, and Sam alluded to this, with talking to you a little bit about my links to this state. Because my decision to reach out to you all and say, can we talk about this, is greatly shaped by my roots in the state of North Carolina. I don't know. Oh, thanks. I realize my background might not be the best. It's really dark there. My family, my parents, were born and raised in Robeson County. On either side of what's now I-95. My mother grew up in a little community called Raft Swamp. Are you familiar with Raft Swamp? And my father in Howellsville Township, east of I-95. Both families were tenant farmers in the tobacco fields there. I was there recently. My dad, who's now 86, likes to go back to his old neighborhoods where, if any of you have histories in farming, particularly in sharecropping or tenant farming, families moved around a lot. So when we go down there, I get to hear about the 15 places they lived between 1935 and 1945. But the picture in the lower right-hand corner is the actual tobacco pack house that my dad worked in on one of the farms, and above that, the fields that he worked. The picture in the upper left-hand corner is the house that my grandmother lived in as I was growing up. And these roots are very important to me, not just coming from this state, but actually the idea that my own family and my family, I have a father who completed the 9th grade, a mom who completed the 11th grade, and I'm really proud to be a first-generation high school graduate. And that just means a lot to me. I was at I threw my parents' 60th wedding anniversary party with all our relatives earlier, and I said something, I shared with my larger family a comment that I often get, given the history of my family's history, and people will say, well, you've really done well for yourself. And I say, I'm a little offended by that comment. I said, first of all, obviously, you don't know how strong my family is and what that means, but that life happiness comes in so many shapes and forms. And I come from a very happy, hardworking, loving, supportive family. I didn't grow up in North Carolina. Before I was born, my father, like so many other young men who were working in the tobacco fields at that time, found a job in Virginia. I grew up in Hopewell, Virginia, which is about 20 minutes outside of Richmond. Those are the schools that I went to. My father worked at one of the chemical factories there. I don't know if this is something to be proud of, and I didn't think about it till I was an adult, but there was a sign coming into one end of the city of Hopewell that labels it the chemical capital of the South. Think about that. It was a wonderful experience growing up in a very working-class, diverse community. I mention all of that for some obvious reasons, but also because of my trajectory as a researcher of literacy and understanding the importance of education and literacy to a person's life and what they might do with their life. So in terms of literacy research at large, there's certainly important driving forces behind attention to literacy and research on literacy, and so at the individual level, for purposes of expanding academic achievement, for individuals in terms of expanding their economic and social mobility, and this was certainly true in my case, collectively, people look at the improvements of literacy instruction in schools collectively to expand democratic engagement, to increase national productivity, economic standing, to look at our competitiveness on the national scene, on the international scene. These are obviously really, really important, and I think if you look at why most people study the advancement of literacy and how to make that happen, it's some combination of these factors, and certainly important to me and where I started. I'm going to take a little bit of a departure from here, though, and bring you back to it. This was certainly my line of thinking, particularly those first two areas of how literacy might be used and literacy development might be used to expand academic achievement, to improve kids' potential for advanced education, for getting good jobs, and so forth. And that was my line of thinking in the early days of my research. I was very interested in understanding reading motivation. I had been a Title I reading teacher in Albemarle County, Virginia. If you know anything about that, that's where Charlottesville sits. But I wasn't teaching in Charlottesville proper or in the areas of the county where, for instance, Muhammad Ali lived, and now where the Trump Winery exists. Mm-hmm. Certainly not in that area, but on the southern end of the county, which was very unique in terms in that county in terms of levels of poverty, and I was always struck by a real mismatch between what it was we had designed for kids to do in school and the kinds of experiences that they had coming into that. And as a sixth grade reading teacher, for instance, kids were walking in who were much more like emergent readers than sixth grade readers. And the real mismatch and the blaming of kids on that mismatch. And I was always really troubled by it. So I was interested in many dimensions of that, but a big part of that was looking at kids' motivations to read. And so my early research was looking at that. And at that time, some of you might be aware that there was a really solid base of correlational type research that looked at kids' motivation to read, and particularly as they moved through the grade level. So it starts off with something like, you know, when kids are in first grade, everybody's pretty high on it, and as they move through the grades, it dwindles and really diminishes on into high school. But at that time, in the mid-1990s, there weren't as many people as you might think who were looking at the context that might influence those dispositions to read. So my early research really looked at the context. And those of you who are doing research in the 90s know this was a big thing that was happening in educational research. And so one of the first questions that I asked was a really simple, broad question to middle school kids about, well, what would motivate you to read? What would motivate you to read? Because it seemed like we were looking at this diminishing disposition, but not really understanding. It's obviously, to me, I know it wasn't something that just clicked off in kids, and so I wanted to understand what it was that caused this decline instructionally. And kids said, in a nutshell, it's the right books, it's given us time in school, and it's when the teachers read things to us that make us see into books and want to read. And that seems simple enough to me. And I felt that after a while, there was lots of repetition of this kind of research But in terms of schools, they still look the same. So we had an idea of how context might shape these things, but not a real practical idea of what would happen if we took these kids at their word and we took them up in earnest, right? And we transformed classrooms to places where these things might happen, because by and large, kids were saying, but these aren't happening in school. I never get to read what I want to read. I never get time. My teacher doesn't really read to me. And I realized nobody had really taken this up. At the time, going back to, I think, reasons why we have lots of people study development of literacy, I was at the time really interested in a very simple chain of events. And that was, if you give kids some choices, what they say would make them read, they do it, and they get better at it. That's where my thinking was at the time. That's exactly where my thinking was at the time. And so this picture here, one of my favorite photos of all time, gives you a sense of what happened pretty early on when about 10 years ago now, a group of teachers in Virginia at a middle school decided to do just that with me, to completely transform the way that they did English classes in eighth grade, all eighth grade teachers in one school. So in a nutshell, they agreed to abandon all assigned reading in this class. All assigned reading, so this wasn't an extra. We inundated these classrooms with books that we thought would speak to kids, particularly kids who weren't normally finding books that spoke to them, particularly kids of color, boys, and so forth. And the teachers also agreed, in the name of autonomy support, to not attach any requirements to the reading of these books. In other words, no quizzes, no response journal, no read this book and build a sand sculpture of a favorite scene from it, nothing like that. It's what you want, even if that means abandoning it. So that seems like, and those of you who do work with schools would go, oh, that seems on the one hand simple. On the other hand, who's going to do that? Particular time when teachers are getting mandates and sort of messages about best practices here and there and so forth. This particular school district, their standardized test scores had fallen so low that honestly, I think what happened was they said, nowhere to go but up, go ahead. And so they ended up giving teachers lots of decision-making power. So it was easy enough, given that situation, across an entire school level, that, you know what, we can actually take kids at their word, because all that we had learned from research, they said, if you give us great books, if you give us time to read to us, we'll read. And this was the easiest thing to have happen. And I thought about how many years we had looked at this research, just sort of in some ways hypothetical, right? But we can actually take them at their word. So that was the easy part. I think the first year that I spent with this particular school district, the number of books, average number of books read, which, you know, that's a little bit loosey-goosey, but was 42. And of course, you know what that means. It was a huge, huge variation there. There were some kids who read 100. I ended up having real issues with that. But we can talk about that a little bit later if you want. And some kids who read 10. But for a kid who had never read anything, who confessed to us that eighth grade was the first time they had ever actually read a book, they weren't faking it, that was a big deal. But, so we could leave it there, and yes, their test scores went up. So even sort of controlling for all kinds of things, their test scores went up. And so we could stop there. But fortunately, research is a space where we as researchers can also be changed. And in my case, it has always been kids' experience that have transformed me. So the teachers and I started noticing there was something more happening here. It wasn't just about kids reading a lot and reading better and being a little more excited and having kids who had never read. And by the way, this included the whole population, including kids with IEPs and English learners. English learners seemed even reap the greatest benefits of this. We started noticing something else. Not only were teachers getting reports from parents, like, what are you doing to my kid? He is reading it at home. you know, that kind of thing. But real changes in kids' dispositions, in their habits, in their behaviors. And comments from kids like this. When I read The Rose That Grew from Concrete, it makes me think about how his environment was growing up. I mean, I lived it. My mom, she had me when she was 17, didn't know exactly where she was going, so it was kind of hard. But his words reminded me of my own self in a way. But it made me feel like I should be more thankful, because I used to be a brat. It makes me feel like I should be more thankful and take more responsibility and doing things that I think are right, trying to help other people out. When I grow up, I'm going to college to be a criminal justice detective or a social worker or something like that. I feel like I have a way in life of helping a lot of people. Can you see so much identity work here? In terms of also of possible future narratives. And so this was becoming fairly widespread. And not only that, as you'll see, we were getting reports from parents of very parallel observations about their own kids and how they were changing. So I began to ask questions, not so much about how do you get kids to read, or how do you motivate kids to read? But I think something more akin to, what are kids' motivations for reading? Why in the world would kids read, first of all? And second, what are the consequences that have sort of consequences of reading, particularly reading narrative, that as a group of researchers and maybe in the world of practice have been in our blind spot? That we have been so focused on something, we've missed a completely different phenomenon with literacy. By the way, I want to, with a caveat, certainly I'm not the first person to notice this, right? That there are other consequences, and there's a lot of evidence of that in this room. I don't know if any of you have read Colleen Fairbanks' work as an early scholar. She had studies of a project called Write for Your Life, which in my experience really stood out early in my career as being looking at kids using literacy as tools for their lives. And certainly it's apparent in the work that's done by all of the literacy faculty in this room. So I'm not saying, well, I'm not the first to notice this. I'm situating my work, I think, in a way of thinking about literacy. And so you already have some phenomenal work around some of these issues here. I happen to look at it from the perspective of reading. So we have a bunch of researchers looking at all of these links to literacy. But I began to really focus my work on looking at literacy, and particularly reading, as a way for people to build more fulfilling lives, in addition to all those other things. By the way, I'm only hypothesizing here, but I think if you focus on the first four of those, you might get those things, but you won't get the last one necessarily. I think if we focus on that last one, I think some of that other stuff actually kind of comes for free. Don't quote me on that. I just have a hunch about it. So, it's just thinking about the big picture. So, this shift then requires sort of re-theorizing about, it's particularly engaged reading, which is the thing that I was really interested in. Not assigned reading, I'm not compliant, but reading when you don't have to and being really deeply immersed in it. But it requires some re-theorizing. So I'll read you here, so you'll get a better sense of what the kids were experiencing, a little piece from one of the students. Something about Living Dead Girl, this is a book that she's talking about, which is has anybody read Living Dead Girl? It's a very provocative book. I won't get into it, but Google it. Google the book, and also the author who is Elizabeth Scott, because otherwise if you just Google Living Dead Girl, you're going to come up with something and you're going to think I'm a nut or a pervert or something. So make sure you're getting the right thing when you Google it. Okay, so she says something about Living Dead Girl. I've always thought people have like more a normal life than a hard life. Then like reading Smile for the Camera and the girl in Love and Leftovers, like especially the girl in Smile for the Camera, it's a true story. I was starting to open up a little bit, realizing I could be wrong about people. Probably there are an amount of people who have a normal life and an amount of people who have an interesting life. I don't know. Living dead girl? I started to be more aware of what people are. I think it's maybe, for example, a family member has cancer, or their parents are divorced, or just anything different than having a normal, big, happy family. I always laughed about this quote because I realized she's not old enough yet to know that her family's really not normal and it doesn't exist. She'll find out later her family's not normal. And she went on to say, I'm the kind of person who always thinks, I hate people. I'm starting to think that maybe they have a good reason. I know that might sound kind of mean, but because, like, I guess I was the kind of person who was sort of judge, you know, and I'm sort of becoming more aware. I've never had a right to judge. I'm becoming more like, I have a better reason not to judge, if that makes sense. And it certainly does make sense to me. We could actually reduce a comment like that to looking at, well, reading fiction creates empathy or leads to empathy. And I'm not belittling the importance of that, but what I would argue is that it's more than that. It's that and then some. By the way, do you know that we actually have little empirical evidence of the links between reading fiction and the expansion of empathy with school-aged children? Most of that work has been done with adult populations. And I think we see it so much in popular media and so forth that there isn't as much research as you might think. And you know where some of the research with adults started? In the business, in workplace relationships, looking at how that might improve workplace relationships. Certainly there are people who have looked at this with young children, but it's not as widespread. I think that it's an experience that a lot of people have had, and it's sort of easy to wrap your head around. But I would say it's even more than that. And I think this perhaps better describes the phenomenon here, the capacity to make ourselves intentional objects and describes ourselves psychologically creates a space of possibility for self-interpretation, of constructing relations with ourselves, so to speak. In the process of enacting psychological descriptions of ourselves as certain sorts of persons, we become the kinds of beings we are. This is an active structuring of existence. Sugarman and Martin. So, in my work, this has really caused me to shift from looking at how readers comprehend text, which is where most of the research, particularly reading comprehension, resides. And that is, how well can you, and it's how what our testing is focused on, how well do you comprehend this text? So a shift from that towards where is now the center of gravity of meaning making, right? So it's no longer, the center of gravity is no longer the text. But really, the center of gravity probably is a little more in the self-text-other sort of dynamic. And looking at how children are using text and the conversations that are inspired by those texts, and those, I should say narratives and characters, as tools for constructing their own lives and constructing how they are going to relate with other people. I only fairly recently started reading more, to be honest, with some of you know transformative learning theory. This has been mainly a theory that's been invoked in studies in adult education. But this seems to have some relationship with the work that I'm doing in reading. The idea that transformation is another word people throw around. Some of you may want to even contest the way I'm using the word transformation, or may use it in different ways. But not just having a response to a particular narrative, but over time, and as part of an ongoing sort of dialogue with a multitude of narratives, creating a real permanent sort of change in how you see the world. to the point where even other people might even notice that you've shifted some. So this goes beyond just having a response to a particular text, but having a more long-term transformation. And also we see here is reading. Reading really is part of a transformative process. So let me give you another example of how I'm thinking about this. This is from another reader. She's talking about the book, If I Stay, and some of you might be familiar with this because it was a movie. If I Stay, it really got me, If I Stay, because the way the girl treated her parents, I kind of treated my parents just like that. Like, I kept on pushing them away from me. I didn't want them to know anything about my life. I was always sneaking around doing things I shouldn't have. And I realized that my parents were going to be there every step of the way, whether I liked it or not. They were going to be there to calm me down. They were going to be there if I was upset or crying. They were going to be there if I was mad. I'm especially inspired by If I Stay There. That's one of the books I won't ever forget. That's one of the stories that's going to stay with me forever because it changed that family's life a lot. And I pretty much changed as much as the girl in If I Stay. One thing that I've noticed in this is the inseparability almost of characters within the social world of a narrative and real people, including yourself, which I think is pretty interesting and also really productive. So this was also noticed by parents. We, and you're going to think that I think I'm two people. And more recently, I've taken on a research colleague in some of this work because I saw it as being really complex, and I really have learned over the years that I am a much better thinker with other thinkers and that I need people to help me think about things. And so Peter Johnston, who is now retired from SUNY Albany, and some of you know his work, has been my research partner on this work, and we decided, because we were hearing so many anecdotal reports from parents saying there have been changes, that we decided we'd actually talk to some of these parents and find out. And so we got reports like this from lots of parents. So this is a mom talking about her daughter. She's been on this journey, and I think several of the things that she read brought a lot of closure this year. She had lost her best friend in sixth grade, so the second half of sixth grade was a lost year for her. She was developing an eating disorder. We put her on Prozac for depression. In seventh grade, she was angry, and that came out very, very clear. She'd be angry with me. She's putting up walls between her and her friends, walls between her and me. In eighth grade, she is healing. I have my daughter back. She read some things that were edgy. She read some things about death. I think it helped her get things in perspective. I think through the reading that she did, it really helped her get to a better place. We had parents tell us things like, I read the books. We found that parents are reading the books. They actually find the books pretty interesting. As you can tell from some of the descriptions, they're provocative. But we had parents tell us, you know, reading the books helps because we actually use them as tools to talk about issues that my son or daughter would never talk to me about, but we use the characters to talk about these important issues. So really, I think beginning to sort of the tip of the iceberg with this kind of thing. But to take it a step further, one thing that we've noticed is that these aren't just passive sorts of transformations, but I think that what we're looking at can be better described as activist sorts of transformations. I want to give you a little bit of a transcript from a conversation that I captured among some boys with no teacher around. Now, I was there, but I don't know what it is about me, but middle school kids don't think I'm an adult, so they say things around me. I don't know if some of you are into that, you have that phenomenon too, but I don't think they consider me an adult, so they say things. But I want you to notice here this active restructuring, as I alluded to before, in a conversation around the book Response. I'm going to apologize for some of the language in here, but I think the language is really important. And it's language that the kids were using. There were four boys, three African-American boys, one Latino young man. They were all reading different books in their classroom. No teacher around. But the kid reading Response was dying for the other kids to read his book, too, so they could talk about it. And so he said he opened up a place in the book, and he gave it to one of them. And he said simply, just read it. Read that. Akeem said, read that. And Rashad, while he's reading, he looks up. And he says, why does it say The N-word. And then he keeps reading. Meanwhile, the other kids gather around and they read over Rashad's shoulder. And they want to read too, and they want to see what he's reading. And he looks up again. What, did he steal something? And Jabbar said, what's that about his shoes? And Rashad said, he called him the N-word. He said, go back to the jungle. Jabbar said, it's racist. Rashad said, it's got to be about whites and blacks. Roberto said, if somebody called me the B-word, that would be racist too. If somebody said that to me, I would take a swing at him. And Rashad said, but you should be chill like Luis. Luis was a character from another book, Perfect Chemistry, that these kids had had a conversation, had had ongoing conversations about. So we have actually found that we can kind of continue to add complexity to how we're looking at engaged reading as potentially transformative in terms of an activist element. And we have found Anna Stetsenko's work to be on relational ontology to be incredibly important. So what we saw there was Rashad becoming really aware of the social and historical influences on his life and his perspectives over time. And I can tell you more and more about Rashad and what led to this, but in a nutshell, recognizing his own role in either perpetuating or changing things, particularly the social practices, and then acting upon it in really productive ways. In this case, trying to even get a friend to consider a different perspective or a different course of action. Keep in mind, this is all without a school assignment. This is all, now don't get me wrong, the teacher was important, but I'll get to that in a minute. But this is pretty amazing, and it speaks to the capacity of children to come to these things when given, when their autonomy is supported, when the stage is set for them to experience something that they deem meaningful of what can happen here. So, inseparably, and I alluded to this just a minute ago, it's the discursive environments of these classrooms that actually greatly shape the kinds of interactions that you saw. And that was just a little tidbit of something that was happening in a bigger way across the school year. And I wanted to give you a sense of some of the discursive environment. Keeping You a Secret is a book that a lot of people, that some people didn't really want to read because they don't agree with the whole gay background of it, the whole gay thing. But some people really take into it, and then talk to some of the people in our school that are like that. I guess got closer than two. I remember Marta was the first one to read it in our class, I think. She was saying how she loved it and how she cried during some parts and how she laughed. So that helped more of us to read it. It's really good. It probably wouldn't have been one of my first choices, but people talking about it definitely convinced me to try it out. A couple of years after that particular group that I probably am going over my time, right? I'm so sorry. Can I keep going? Is that okay? So interrupt me. I knew I would do this. Half an hour? Are you kidding me? So a couple of years later, with one of the groups, we went back and we tried to get them about 3 years later to get their later perspectives on what an eighth grade year meant, what it meant that year. And I think this particular example just says a lot, and this in some ways really blows my mind, the capacity of children to articulate, to understand their experiences, to articulate them this way in that kind of environment. This was a young woman who was an English learner. She said, I just felt like it wasn't a class. She's talking about her eighth grade English class. It was just like, sit down and talk, like in a way it was for some people. I understand they were going through some personal things. I mean, every teenager does, whether it's big or small, or we just blow it out of proportion. Because, you know, that's just what we do. And so it's like throughout the book, you could, in a way, always find yourself somewhere. And like I was saying, like it's like a life lesson type thing, because it's like, you know, you may not want to express what you're going through, but this book does it without you even having to say it. And that's the cool part about urban fiction, because it's like today and the way you talk, and you can just relate to a character and get attached, and you're like, I should handle it this way. And it gives you a different points of view. And so that class, you were just basically talking about yourself, but at the same time you weren't, and you just don't have to give it away like that. That blows my mind. And I know that Peter and I have struggled with an existing theory of reading that really captures or explains this tremendous phenomenon. In some ways makes us look at what have we been doing? What are we going for when we're teaching kids to comprehend? What is it that we're going for? She goes on to talk about what she saw, about her teachers, because I think this is important and a point that I wanted to stress. I think we've become a lot closer because we have the same tastes in books, and we know we're on the same page. And our thoughts, when one person finishes off, another person starts and picks up the other person left off. Yes, this is a teenager talking about their teacher. And I think it also speaks to the discursive environment of the classroom, which I think brings up the point that we many times in lots of research and reading, we think so much about what are the strategies used, what are the materials that we used, and not looked at enough, I think, is the influence and the power of the interactions in the classroom. And this wasn't a matter of teachers simply providing kids some choice and providing materials. But it was heavily shaped by the interactions in those classrooms and the relational properties of the classrooms. And not only that, what it was that the teachers began to imagine that they were actually doing when they said they were teaching kids to read. It leads me to these kinds of thoughts. With where I am in my work, presumably the goal of education would be to advance humanity, not just sustain it. And it seems that in so many of our literacy practices currently, the goal is to really sustain, to take kids to a certain point. And that's in many ways what our standards do that we're shooting for, and not to really advance it, and not to work so that kids actually become activists, so that they become agents of change. I don't know how well we're doing that in literacy to this point. How do we make it so that they become the next generation that makes change, both in their own relationships and more globally? I believe it has to start with the instruction that we're offering. It's led me to ask questions like, why do we have children read literature in the first place? Is it so that they can tell you what the main idea is or what you thought the author's message was? It seems like there are bigger fish to fry here. And I think it really makes sense to take a look at that. And then related, how is it that we might teach reading in such a way that students learn to build more meaningful lives for themselves? This is not separate from what literacy is and does in a person's life. I've been really struck by looking recently in some data that was analyzing and looking at how to frame it, some longitudinal data, and there's so much call for we need students to become lifelong readers, right? You hear that, that's almost a soundbite. We want people to become lifelong readers. And then the National Endowment of the Arts does these studies every once in a while and it says adults aren't reading or particular adults aren't reading. And then I'm question, what are we doing K-12 in schools to give reasons for kids to, or people to become, to continue to adulthood, to be lifelong readers? And I think it's a really, we have to look at why it is that you'd want to read in the first place and what that does for, what a person sees that it might do for their lives. In schools, a big piece of that is helping, I think, in terms of teacher education, is looking at how teachers might be able to envision expanded goals, expanded ways of learning through literacy that aren't really on their radar at the moment. The teachers that we work with, with all of these mandates taken away and some flexibility, and I know that's a tall order, and this was in a research situation, but it was possible for them to be able to then see new goals, things they hadn't imagined, reasons for teaching they hadn't imagined. This is a quote from one of our eighth grade teachers. The goals change, don't they? Books are not the destination like we thought they were. We thought books were the cure. Not true. I want to see them more compassionate, more empathetic. I want them to see each other without stereotypes. I want them to read without realizing. I want them to be empowered to choose their own books, to be readers for life. That's a whole shift. I think just getting the books in the classroom, that was the original plan, but that's not the plan any longer. I think we've realized there's a lot more to it than that. This is a huge deal to me, to have this shift in, the shift in what I think I'm doing when I'm teaching kids to read. Unfortunately, as I know that we're facing, this is a quote from a teacher in Wisconsin. I'm imagining that this is a dilemma here in describing what she's dealing with in terms of literacy, curriculum, instruction, and mandates in her school. She said it this way, and she's naming all the different programs and initiatives they're dealing with. Common Core, Daily Five, Calkins, Fountas and Pinnell, Fidelity to a Curriculum, Compliance and Response Intervention, Workshop, Conferring, Charlotte Danielson, Badger, Forward, Dibble, Star, WSRA, IRA. Our hearts believe in student-centered instruction, but our heads are swimming in the array of instructional methods and seemingly contradictory expectations. We yearn for the confidence and resources to be role models and leaders with a concise, research-based, contemporary message. This is a hard thing here. This is reality. This is a hard thing. So I think that my philosophy about this shift that I see as being really helpful to our future in terms of kids and their literacy is helping teachers also see as children, and I think as our teachers experience, as children see that have taken on themselves as deliberate projects through their reading, and they have taken themselves on as deliberate objects of transformation. I believe that if we could see literacy teacher education and helping as a way of helping teachers see becoming a teacher as an ongoing process of the transformation of self. You probably have encountered the same thing that I do at the University of Wisconsin and other places, especially in our undergraduate programs, where if our students aren't learning skills and strategies for teaching methods the second week, they're going, when are you going to start teaching me how to teach? And because they see teaching as a set of skills to be acquired and not as the growth and development of personhood. And that's a really, really important thing and a really important job for us. And again, coming back to this really important question of what is it as a teacher that I think I'm doing when I'm teaching literacy? And I think that some of our curriculum materials that lots of teachers are being told they have to use actually so distort thinking on that, on what it is that I think I'm doing. It really does. It really distorts our views on what we think we're doing. So I say all that to give you an idea as I've thought about, doing this from afar and thinking about this given the information that I have of how I might see my role if given the opportunity to have the Moran Distinguished Professorship here and how I see it. First of all, in terms of my own research, I want to continue to follow this line of research of looking at the development of meaningful literacies that expand people's lives, their personal lives, their social relational lives, their socio-emotional growth. I also believe, and you'll see a theme running through here, that I believe that there is great appeal in graduate programs where people actually see opportunities to grow themselves. I heard that, and I just heard other places, that there's not a lot of financial incentive for someone to get their master's degree in North Carolina. Mm-hmm. Is that true?
That is true.
And so I, as you believe, people are driven by so many other things if they know that those options are available. And I think that the places where I've seen the most kinds of meaningful graduate programs is where teachers come out on the other end and they say, I'm not just a different teacher now, I'm a different person. And I think that's where most people fall, is wanting ways to grow themselves. And I think then that becomes the motivator if they see that as a possibility. So I have great hope about that. I also see people who do this, who experience that, those kinds of transformations as educators, are some of the same people who become our finest doctoral students, who pursue doctoral programs, and who want to become researchers to keep learning more, and to keep growing themselves more. I certainly view my own research as hopefully that it helps the world, but I know that it helps me. I know that it grows and changes me, at least I hope in positive ways. I think that this idea is not separate. And I've been in all kinds of institutions where, especially, you know, graduate programs are a constant struggle in terms of the accessibility, financial, time-wise, all of those things. So I think there need to be in place ways, strategies for people to see the possibilities for their own lives and for their practice. I think coupled with the growth of graduate programs would be real hands-on engagement with Greensboro area schools, which I know is the Guilford County schools, and Greater North Carolina schools, with long-term hands-on partnerships. I'm a person who likes to get in and get in there myself. If we had more time, I would talk. If you want to talk privately, I can talk about some community engagement projects that I'm currently involved in Wisconsin that have been really powerful and helped my thinking about this quite a bit. I think that there is a lot of potential for this kind of work if we... you know how, aren't you guys are all troubled by the uses of the term research-based practice. So I'm really drawn, maybe not in the exact ways that Tony Bright talks about it, but I'm really inspired by the way he talks about, instead of research-based practice, practice-based research. So I see all of these things being connected. Engagement with the community, engagement with public schools in the state of North Carolina, to do research together, so practice-based research that is genuinely based in practice. I fully believe, as I mentioned before, that big things happen when lots of people put their minds to it. And so collaborative activities, not just from the UNCG literacy faculty, but cross-discipline collaboration. You know, I did a little sneaking around. You know, the internet makes it possible for me to actually know who you are before I get here. And so I was struck by how many links there were really between people and the kind of work that they do here, and I was really excited about that. And I'll be honest with you, I saw myself, you may not see that, I saw myself fitting nicely with that in terms of the values that I have, but I'll let you be the judge of that. I learned this through the endowed professorship that I have at Wisconsin now, about the importance of strategically funding these things. And I think much of this has to come from private sources. I would see that as part of my role in obtaining some of that, because I think that seed money in particular, to get things off the ground and to support existing wonderful initiatives that you have, like your Young Writers Camp, which seems also a very powerful initiative already underway, so that other people, and then using the university's external communications networks, so that other people know. Because if there's one thing that I've learned in the past few years, it that there are people out there who have graduated from our institutions who are very, very interested in education. They're very interested in looking at ways to support. And I know it's very true in literacy. You mentioned the word reading, people go nuts. There are people who really want to support that. They're looking for ways for examples that they find really compelling. And so I was telling a group last night, an initiative that I'm part of in Wisconsin now, I've never been particularly really good at tuning my own horn and putting my work out there, but my colleagues and I were sort of like forced to do this because we were engaged in a community initiative that was funded by some very high-profile donors at my institution. So it had to get out there. But what I was really so heartened by were in alumni magazines that went out, in web blasts and so forth, people all over the country who had graduated from our programs who saw it and said, I want to give $5,000. I want to give this much. This is something that I can get behind. And so much of it was compelling because we were actually doing work with teachers, with kids in schools. And I think that's important for a number of reasons, but they're also really practical reasons. And I think people do find that compelling. And they see that's where there are going to be big differences and changes. And so I don't have the specifics on these, but I know these are things that have to happen to really get really powerful, impactful initiatives off the ground. So I've gone way over my time, but I just want to leave you with some continuing questions that I have that I'll continue to follow and things that I would love to have conversations with you about. And that is, first, how do we help children see literate practices as opportunities to grow? How do we help them learn to initiate literacy and learning practices? How do children and teachers learn to ask questions, seek uncertainty, and recognize problems as opportunities to learn? And finally, and probably the one that I think is the most important, how do we awaken and encourage a person's capacity for self-transformation? Thank you for being so kind. I went way over my allotted time. Thank you.
Open it up for maybe 5 minutes or so of questions.
I apologize for that.
It's okay.
If you want to ask questions, even practical questions about my work, or maybe you don't, but I'm any kind of questions, I'm happy to have a conversation with you.
Well, this is, an observation. Melody and Amy and I and some other colleagues have been working on developing professional development around writing, and it strikes me as interesting that we often discourage kids from using personal experience or personal observations as part of the development of arguments, and yet one of the things that this sort of work shows that I think also works in writing is that when you begin to examine yourself in relation to other events, other people, when you start interpreting your experiences, it allows you to come up with those ideas about what this is about, why this means. And so the combination of this kind of reading and this kind of writing would be very interesting to explore.
It's so funny because we've just looked at reading, but there's such a parallel in writing, and there are also equally parallel issues that people are encountering. People are given writing programs where they're told you can't use personal stories, or you can't imagine yourself as a character. You can write about Superman, but you can't write about being Superman, in other words, you know, of not trying to imagine yourself into a situation. And so I think there are very parallel tensions and opportunities with writing, absolutely, for sure.
One of the things that my colleagues and I did was we worked with kids with autism, adolescents with autism, and because of the social communication challenges they experienced, we saw personal narrative as the door in to helping them kind of look at those things. So what we did was we actually used personal narrative books, and we taught them how to write personal narratives of their own, and through that work we kind of found that their inner lives were far more interesting than their outer lives kind of led you to believe. And we had things like one young woman writing about how their Thanksgiving dinner was less than the typical American Thanksgiving dinner, and she just thought it was horrible that her family went to a Chinese restaurant for and, you know, another person explaining how upset she was because she didn't get to go shopping for the wedding dress with her friends. And then another young man explaining how he got back at his sister for messing up his games and how he learned not to mess up his sister's games anymore because she retaliated. So this whole idea of using personal narrative, I think one of the reasons that it doesn't happen as much is it's not in our standards.
It's not, and you know, you're reminding me, we had probably a handful of kids who who had Asperger's in our work. And I remember one in particular who she gravitated towards memoir where written by people with Asperger's. And I said, what is that about for you? She says, it's like experiencing something with a friend. And she really, it's the same thing, like the capacity there that's untapped. And we found that the kids who had Asperger's were very engaged in the conversations. She said to me, she said, I used to, at the end of the year, she said, you know, I used to get angry at my mom because what I saw around the house were all these books on psychology, Asperger's and autism. And I said, what'd you think of that? And she said, it made me mad, like she's trying to figure me out. And I said, what do you think of it now? And she said, I get it. And now I think I'd like to read those books. And to me, that was just really, she's also a kid who would, I remember at the end of the year interviewing her, she talked a lot, At the end of the day, she came in and she found me in another room and she said, did I talk too much today? And I thought, wow, that's like that in and of itself. And I said, you know, that's what an interview is supposed to, you're supposed to talk during an interview. So yeah, you did good. You did just the right thing. But those kinds of things, and I just, it really, really rocked me to see kids responding in those ways, in ways that they were always there. It's just making it possible to see it and possible for it to happen. I found it really exciting. So I'm going to be really interested in reading your work.
I think we're out of time, right, Amy?
Well, the next appointment is at 11:30. So why don't you want to ask your question, Heidi, and then we'll stop after that.
Sure. I was wondering if you could talk a little bit about your Literacy by the Lakes project, because that's working with teachers, and it might present a different, a supplement to what you were talking about here with a focus on learners.
We had, as a group of faculty members in my department, there are four of us, and we had an opportunity with some seed money from a donor to provide, it was an earmark for professional development and literacy around the state. And so last year, we invited school districts from around the state of Wisconsin to apply and to come and join us for a 3-day sort of retreat in August on campus. We called it Literacy by the Lakes. It's corny, but people like it. Madison sits on an isthmus, those of you who have been there, so they love their lakes. So we invited teams, and one administrator had to be included, and they came and they joined us for 3 days, which we were able to pay for, which was really important, because they didn't, otherwise it's difficult to have this kind of experience. Where there was a general focus, and that is on developing meaningful literacies. Those of you who have been around me and see, this is a real theme in everything that I do. And so we had in speakers, and the professors themselves, we ourselves did the workshops, which was really important. And by the end of the 3 days, the teams, which had time to work together, were able to then to come together on what is, when we go back to our school districts, what's a goal that we want to work on? What's one big thing we want to work on together this year? And so they went away, and then we, the four of us faculty members, divided up these 20 teams, and each of us have 5 that we're working with, and we have supported across the school year. And so we have gone, and some of them have invited us to come in and spend time in their classrooms, to read to kids, to give books, do you need articles? What is it that you want to focus on? And the idea, and I don't know if I've gotten to all of this, but the idea is that some of those teams will come back this coming August, and they begin to provide some of the professional development. And so there will be this huge network. It was an amazing experience. It has been, I think, an amazing experience for us, but also for the teachers who, some of the comments that we got were, we've never been treated this professionally in our lives, because they were given lots of choices, and really good food, I might add. At the conference, which was a big deal. It's really a big deal. But this idea that you're gonna support us with something we want to do, as opposed to being told what to do, and to have a real stake in it, to have real investment, you're supporting us with what we have come to believe. This was not uninformed. So they spent 3 days, and what we hope to do during the 3 days we spent with them is give them some possibilities that they might not have considered before, and say, here's some ways of thinking about this. Does this resonate with you? And letting them take a look at these possibilities and then choosing things to go after. And it's been a really remarkable, I think we're going to have, we just started it last year, I think we'll have a lot more, even more participation. I think we worked with 20 different school districts across the state, and it's been some of the most rewarding work that I've ever done. But I can see the multiple sorts of positive consequences coming from that already. And people feel connected to the university. That's a really important thing, particularly in rural districts that don't have a lot. So for us to be able to offer, to even say, we can give you $1,000 worth of books, actually was just what they need to get started. But rural districts who don't have a lot of access to universities and to feel like, some of them ask, you know, and I'm going to teach a class, can I actually put like some University of Wisconsin logo? Because this will mean something to the kids. And it does. It means a lot to these kids. So that's a little in a nutshell.
Okay. Let's give Gay a round of applause. Thank you.